introduce our speaker. He has started his VC career for over 20 years. And in the past decades, he has also held executive positions in many large international companies. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Peter Hsieh. There you are.
谢谢. Hi, everyone. My name is Peter Hsieh. It is a great honor to be invited back to here to speak to you and share my observations in Silicon Valley again. When I was sitting down there with the audience, I realized probably 95% are people from Taiwan. And the topic today is to explore Taiwanese tech company startup opportunities. So I figured it's probably better that I speak in Chinese. 因为这样子的话呢，大家吸收的程度比较快一点点。我这个出国已经差不多30年了，我发现我们在国外呢，即使英文讲得很溜，还是得有一个 mathematical processor 在旁边在讲英文的时候。所以在台下的各位，假如是一边要听听手机，然后刷刷手机，一边要再听我的演讲，我觉得用中文来讲，大家可能吸收的好一点点。好，今天想跟大家探讨的话题是这样子的，大家都听过一个名词叫做独角兽。独角兽这个名词，我大概是4年前开始听说的。那么，所谓独角兽的意义就是，通常指的是一个 private company， 就是没有上市的公司，但是它的市值超过了$1 billion， 也就是10亿美金。好，但是呢。 针对台湾的公司来说怎么办？因为台湾的这个资源是非常非常有限的，所以说我在这一个演讲里头要跟大家分享的是，哪一些独角兽所花的钱少于1亿，或者是1.25亿，或者是2亿美元达成了独角兽。Believe it or not， 其实这样子独角兽已经非常少了。那么第二件事情就是说，哪一些公司从开到 成为独角兽呢，总共花的时间是少于7年。为什么用7年来看呢？因为一个 venture capital fund 的 life cycle 基本上就是7年，可能 extend 8年或者是 extend 到10年。所以7年是一个做创投的人来说很重要的一个时间。那第三点呢，我们要看的就是说，我们坐在台湾，因为我们的母市场比较小，那怎么样能够有机会创造一个独角兽？这事实上是我今天最主要想要探讨的一个问题。好。 这里就稍微吹牛一下，我是1986年台大机械系毕业，然后1993年 Stanford 拿的博士，念的是超音波跟光学，在今年的愚人节，也就是4月1号，我在这个行业已经干了差不多近这个行业20年了，从头到尾呢，我大概创造了一些有机会或已经有一些是独角兽了。目前为止，我所投资的公司，他们总共加起来创造的市值大概比这里的数字要多一点，有70多亿美金了哈。 这一张也是要吹牛一下，讲一下Acorn Pacific， 就是我现在所属的这个 venture capital firm。这里其实就是在矽谷的优秀华人过去，从1970年代的一个杰出的历史，稍微的看一下，就是从1970年代的公司一路到2000多年的这些公司，就是这个 Acorn 的这个 network 里头有是我们的前身叫 Acorn Campus 里头的 partner， 或者是一些是我们基金的投资人，他们自己开的公司或者他们所投资的公司所创造出来的市值可以看得到是100个 billion US dollar 以上。那么这一张很快的介绍一下，在 TechCrunch 它的这个页面上，我下面都有附注上我的出处哈，所以大家有兴趣可以把它拍一个照，把这个出处上去 click 就可以找得到这些图了。 这里基本上就是说，现在在5月17号，全世界达到变成是 unicorn 的公司，总共有195家，分列在这么多个这个 space 里头。我当然不可能一个一个 icon 195跟你们谈，只是告诉你们在网上找得到这样的资料，什么样的公司在什么样的 sector。比方说，我们有，哎，这个怎么玩？对不起啊。 哦，这个镭射笔没什么用。E-commerce, social, internet, fintech 就是台湾讲的，我不知道中文怎么说。Cybersecurity 类似这样的公司，在不同的行业有人做过这样的分析，所以大家在网上可以很容易的找到。然后你要在里头一个一个进去抽丝剥茧的看，你所想要开的公司适合在哪一个 sector 里面，然后在这个 sector 里头有哪些是既有的赢家。这一张更 busy， 这张是我自己 created 的，但是它的网页在下面 TechCrunch 的网页。我为了这次的演讲跟大家分享了一下，总共融资少于 125个 million 以下的 private company， 最小的融资是 30个 million， 最多融到 125， 这是我的 cut off 的 line， 就说有这么多家公司。 他们融的钱少于 125个 million， 但是他还是有机会成为独角兽。稍微再仔细进去看一下，这类的公司里头呢，绝大部分还是美国公司，然后中国的公司大概是美国公司的一半左右。然后我们再往下来看，这个 sector 我们不要看，接下来这一大堆呢，我这个里面不用看了哈，主要要讲的就是这个公司所在的一些行业。 然后呢，再来再去分析说这些公司从开张到现在总共花了几年的时间，这件事情很重要，就是我刚刚讲的七年的这件事情，因为大家都说 VC 是很没有这个耐性的，没有办法，因为 VC 自己也是一个生意，它有一个基金的年限的限制。接下来我就把刚才这张 slide 里头密密麻麻的这些文字帮大家做了一个功课。 做的功课就是这张上面讲的，哪一些 key terms 发生在刚才的那张 slide 里头，然后应该是有一点意义的。我们可以看，有一些 term 叫做 app， data analytics， predictive analytics， artificial intelligence， 这一边是在 software oriented 的地方，再下来，软跟硬的整合方面比较多。这个区分也许是我个人比较这个为了今天的演讲硬生生的分成这几块，但是大家不要就叫它软硬整合 ，AR VR 这种东西 ，computer vision， HMI 就是这个 human machine interface， intelligent robot IoT， 然后在市场上面呢，针对的有 industrial enterprise， 还有 cross border。 cross border 的意思就是说，比方说从我坐在的矽谷跟亚洲这里做一些连接。 还有一些是 social 上面的 discovery sharing P2P community， 还有一些其他的。这是我针对上面的这张 slide， 我再重复一次，这些字里头我发现哪些字是比较重要的，帮大家分析出来。然后我们再往下看，下面这张 curve 我也很努力的建议大家有空的话可以到 Gartner 的网页上去，就是到 Google 去找这个 keyword Gartner hype cycle for emerging technology。 每一年的6月、7月份左右 ，Gartner 都会 publish 一张这样子的图，所以在这个下面的这个网页呢，他帮我们做了一些功课，把 Gartner 过去4年、13、14、15、16所认为什么样的技术是未来很快要发生的。在读这张图的时候，要注意到它里头不同形状或不同颜色的 icon， 可能有一些是说，嘿，要变成真实的要花小于2年，2年到5年，5年到10年或者超过10年以上，那么。 这些 curve 很有趣的一个比较，就是大家要去看，哎，去年很 hot 的，我们来讲吧，这里其实是看不清楚的，但是你们自己到网上就可以看，去年很 hot 在这里的公司，有没有一些公司到这里就已经不见了？不见的意思就是说这个 hot 已经 bubble 泡沫化了，就不存在。有一些公司呢，很顺利的过了这个门槛，往下掉，然后呢，再到这儿又活回来一些行业，然后慢慢慢慢的可以。 在这里做一个稳定的增长，所以大家要去思考的就是，你所要开的公司到底是在这个地方，很有可能跑到这连这整个行业都不见了，还是你要做的是在这里？我个人觉得都可以考虑，因为做这里呢，事实上有很多公司很天价、很高价被卖掉。做这里的话呢，就要像今天稍早的一个 session 要讲，叫做 startup， 必须要能够挣钱啊，要 prove the business model， 慢慢来。所以两个地方都有它的 merit。 在接下来，因为今年 Computex 的主轴是说要做什么 IoT 啊 ，Big Data、Artificial Intelligence， 可是我发现我跟我周遭的朋友去聊天，发现很多人其实不太清楚他们真正的意义在哪儿。然后尤其我们很尊敬的李开复先生前几天不是说 AI 好像在台湾不太有机会吗？所以我稍微跟大家讲一下它的定义。第一件事情，你必须要有 access 到很大的一个 data set， 很大。 因为太小的话，其实它没有办法生成任何的物理或商业上的意义。那所以呢 ，IoT 跟 Big Data 是要 intimately connected，IoT Internet of Things， 它一定要有很多的 thing 才能产生很多的 data。那有很多个 billions of connected things 会 by definition generate massive amounts of data， 再来就是软硬 platform service opportunity 才在这样的情况下会发生。再来的话，你有了这么多的 data， 你要怎么办？这些 data 必须有两种可能性，一个在 edge 的地方就已经被 process 掉了，一个要跑到 central 的地方，或者是一些 hierarchy 的方式上去，在中间被 process 掉，或者是在上面再被 process 掉。很仔细的去想，假如各位是不管当过兵啊，或者在一个公司里头担任过主管，都会想，一个比较小的兵，他有很多报告不一定能够报告给总经理。我们就假设在 big data 这个行业里头，最后的这个大的很大云端的这个 server 就是大老板。所以很小的兵，他所吸收到的一些 data， 需不需要直接 process 送到那边去 process？ 大老板不一定每个东西都要听啊，对不对？所以在 edge 端的 process 很重要。所以这里头就是要告诉大家。IoT 里头有很多事情，尤其到最后 migrate 到 artificial intelligence， 一定是第一件事情。我们再重说一次，有很多的 sensor， 有很多的人在产生很多的 data， 然后这些 data 不管在 edge， 在中间或者在最后面很大的云里头，要去被 process， 要被去 organize， 再来才能够有机会 organize 之后才去学习。Someone is asking me to use English, so I'll just switch to English. If we are going to be able to process the data and come down here, then with enough organized data, process data, either you go by doing training, meaning human involved to train the data, to train the computer to learn, or the computer develops its own neural network to process, then you will be able to generate artificial intelligence. Now, because we have limited time, I have so many things I would like to share. This is what I see basically every startup company I look at.I look at whether the company has technology innovation, or it's just a technology integrator, or it has a unique and new business model. The best part is if you have all three, that's the best. But sometimes if you only have the left-hand side, the technology, then you're still okay. But a lot of the company are here on the right-hand side, but they still manage to be successful. The most famous example in this category, on this end, is the company that you guys all know. It's called Uber.Uber lost $2 billion last year. It has managed to raise about $50 or $60 billion, but still a unicorn, the largest unicorn right now. So what I look at is, if you have limited resource, and by definition, I share with you guys, I would like to see unicorns that have raised less than $125 million. My emphasis to you and my suggestion to you is to go more towards here, less there, because here,requires a significant entry barrier that's built upon money. And money is called resource. That's something that we don't really have here. Creating opportunities. Here we talk about technology, integration, and business. This is just a reflect of what I just shared with you in the last slide. Key technology requires, like, these are just examples.IC, sensor component, precision machinery, integration, business. I can pause for 10 seconds for you to read this, and now time's up. Now, quickly, I would like to share with you about some examples that I believe these are companies that could have been created in Taiwan, but unfortunately, it's created elsewhere. These are opportunities me as a hardcore engineer,and the guy that loves Taiwan, grew up in Taiwan, think Taiwanese companies should explore for themselves. Oh, that's my time over there. For example, there's a company that is very hot called Quanergy. How many of you have heard of this company called Quanergy? Can you raise your hand? Good, we have about less than five people that have heard of the company. How many of you use a vacuum robot at home? Can you raise your hand? Okay.About triple that number. 大家在家里头、oh, I was ordered to speak in English. Vacuum robot at home, be able to walk around, understand the environment, or your autonomous vehicle, 自驾车 be able to drive around. A very important component of that is called LiDAR. LiDAR is spelled L-I-D-A-R. There is a company called Velodyne, which makes LiDAR and also makes subwoofer for audio device stereo systems. A retail LiDAR is sold traditionally for $7,000. 7,000. That's why a lot of autonomous vehicles are trying to get away from that, and a lot of the iRobot type of vacuum cleaner you have at home doesn't use a very nice LiDAR. But this company, Quanergy, is a semiconductor company which also creates a component and device that looks like this, and be able to use hardcore technology to do significant cost down, plus hardware, plus software, to enable a unicorn. The cost, performance, size, and reliability metrics exceed those of existing state-of-the-art solutions by 1 to 2 orders of magnitude. 也就是说它的价钱还有它的 performance 比现在最好的差10倍到100倍。 So this is what we call technology breakthrough. Think about it, what's inside? There's electronics, there's DSP, there is optics, there is mechanical part, there is some software. Why do you guys think Taiwanese company cannot make other semiconductor? Hey, we are the strongest semiconductor island in the whole world, right? So I believe this is a company that we should collectively think, originally $7,000 made by Velodyne. Now, do a significant cost down. I remember probably 20 years ago, an LCD monitor in the US cost about $1,000. Now it's less than $100. That's called breakthrough, and that's done by Taiwanese, right? So I'm just shooting this out as an example. This is a company we should have done, but somehow we missed it. It's okay, because there are more of these things that are happening. Another company you guys all know recently, acquired by Intel, called Mobileye. This is a company in Israel. And it's also some type of hardware and software integrated system that enables autonomous vehicles. The above two companies both are worth over $1 billion. Have you guys heard of this company? I don't even know how to pronounce it. UBEC? This is a company out of Shenzhen. 中国的一家公司. This is literally the product they have. It can walk around, it can do dancing, it can talk to you. A Shenzhen company. Shenzhen就是大陆的那个深圳, huh? And it also makes these toys for kids. This company is worth over $1 billion. So this is another company I believe Taiwanese companies should be able to do. 看不到,你是工作人员吗? 你刚刚有一张纸,不是告诉我时间,对不起。 This is another company, it's already a public company called Intuitive Surgical. When you guys go to hospitals, sometimes you will see a banner said, 达文西机器人的这个手术的,有没有看到? Da Vinci. This company is the company that makes the Da Vinci robotic system to provide doctors to do very precision operations on their patients. The company is worth several billion dollars. It is based out of San Jose. A classmate of my daughter's mother, whose mother works for here, and the daughter rides horses in birthday parties, gives out very nice gifts because this one company makes its employees very rich. Yeah? So I'm saying, this is another company. Why do I believe we can accomplish this? Because people in my age, when I was at Jianguo Zhongxue, all the good students go to Bingzu and become doctors in Taida Yike, 或者是北医后, whatever, right? Only the secondary people like ourselves go to, maybe I'm just exaggerating a little bit, go to engineering school. But if you have such doctors with market insights and skill set, plus the engineering talents here in Taiwan, how come this company is not producing Taiwan? But make sure that you understand this is engineering plus medical. It is not pharmaceutical plus engineering, which I think is a little bit different story that I will not touch today. Another company, have you guys heard of this company? Peloton. Peloton is the latest unicorn. Literally, what you see in retail shop is a spinner. 就是一台这个健身的脚踏车. This is their deliverable. Do you guys know how much is sold per unit? Will you pay for that? $2,000, a spinning machine. But this is a unicorn company. Why, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen? It enables streaming of real-time classes so that you can interact with other people that are interested in this. So there's a community. There is also a live coach that interfaces with you. So this is actually, the deliverable of this company is actually not the machine. It is the streaming service, the business model behind that. And I believe Taiwanese love to do sports to better their shape. So we have insights here, and we have so many people living elsewhere in the world. I believe this is a company that could have been developed in Taiwan. The difficulty is, dare we charge $2,000?
我们敢不敢一台机器卖人家2000块？ 每个月在收费?
I think that's a big question for every one of you. Dare you develop a company that makes a spinning machine while charging $2,000 and charge a monthly subscription fee by developing a community and a live streaming with Coach? Now, this is another company because I'm building a house in the US now, so I'm surveying the market. So this company is not a unicorn, but I think it's a company worth your interest to look at. What does it do? The company's name is called Ring. Now, these data may not be accurate, and this data may not be accurate because the company CEO declines and saying that the data is not accurate. This is just a data I picked up from this website called PitchBook. But I think more or less it is correct. The deliverable of this company is a video doorbell, a surveillance camera with light. How boring is that?
就是你家门口的一个门铃装了一个 camera, 然后有云端的储存,有 motion detection, 然后你在 Taiwan, 假如你美国的家有人按这个门,
if someone rings your doorbell here in the US while you are here in Taiwan, you can pick up your phone and in real time speak to the other guy that's pushing the doorbell button. And this is just another connected device. Why does the company need to have raised how much money? The latest round of financing, which just took place in January this year, they raised $109 million. This is not crazy. This is actually happening. And the latest round is led by Kleiner Perkins, which is tier one venture capital firm in the United States. Why are they doing this? Dare you create a video doorbell, sell it, for example, for $199, charge people $3 a month, and be able to create a unicorn. Now, what I heard is behind the story, what's happening here is, in the United States, when you get one of these video doorbell installed, somehow there's a concentric circle of installation that's happening. Your neighbors see, hey, this thing looks cool. Where did you buy it? So ripple effect, gradually the whole community buys it. And then another data point is police station are reporting that for locations that install this, crime rate actually drops. This company has rate, let's do some mathematics here.
2亿.
About a little bit over $200 million for a video doorbell. So I will urge my Taiwanese friends here, 我的同胞, think about how to use 我们闭着眼睛都会做的东西, but create a community, create a social effect, create some business model that's sticky enough. Dare to dream that these things can happen in Taiwan. Thoughts? Either you go small, you create components like the LiDAR, remember? Like another company that I invested about 10 years ago called AOI. It's started by 台湾清华大学的毕业生是美国的这个博士. It's a company based out of Texas. It went public, and recently its market cap exceeded $1 billion. What they do is very high-end laser module. So my recommendation is, if you are a hardcore engineer, do this. Create something that's small, component subsystem, and compete on technology. Or if you are not like that, dare to think big, find the tipping point business strategy where you can, after all stars are aligned, create some kind of business model and momentum that takes off. If I have time, I will share some examples and thoughts with you. This is the last slide of my formal presentation. Lots of opportunities for Taiwanese startups.
Number one is you need time and money. Remember that video doorbell company actually raised so far over $200 million? So you need money. Being able to raise 1亿 台币, 2亿 台币, 5亿 台币 in Taiwan to people in Silicon Valley means nothing. Even the credit card company that my previous honorable presenter presented, a company called PLASTC that makes a universal credit card, the company folded, went bankrupt. Crowdfunding, how much money did they raise? 9 million. And how much money is 9 million Taiwanese dollars? 3亿 台币. 花了3亿 台币一公司关了, 但是在美国这其实是稀松平常的事情. So dare to think big, but think about this. You need money. And if in Taiwan we have so many angel investors, Series A investors, where does the growth money come from? The growth money doesn't seem to be here. But in the United States, in China, you can see a lot of VCs are chasing after good deals. So think about it. Don't just do business and be happy if you're a king here in Taiwan, a king here in Korea, a king in Japan. That, to people that are living in a larger piece of land, think it's too small a market. Okay, that's number one. Number two is by time, you need tenacity. 就是你要能够有毅力, 要能够支持下去, 成就一家公司不容易啊, 7年都已经很快了. That's number two. Technology and integration. That's your core, because I think Taiwan started out as a technology island. People, people, people. You want to be able to find right people, right investor, right partners. Market. I will urge people to think about, have a big dream, to think about large market. And a brief recap. You need a lot of things to be able to create data, and then only after that will you be able to have artificial intelligence. And this is a very simple thinking process. You first have data access, and then you collect the data, you process the data, transmit the data, and then process the data at the edge, or in a secondary ring, do analytics, do recommendation, do learning, then you have artificial intelligence. Now, within each segment, there are a lot of hardware and software that can be produced, and also a lot of business model that can be produced. Within each arrow, similarly, a lot of things can be thought about. That's why I say there are plenty of opportunities for Taiwanese startups. The key is you look at each one of the segment and think about what you're the best at. Or occasionally, the next point, occasionally refer to the Gartner hype curve that I just shared with you, because it is just some type of opinion. It's not really something you seriously believe it as a religion. And the last two points, number one is called read Malcolm Gladwell's book. And then think through your business model. I still have 2.5 minutes. I want to share a little bit about my backup slides. To create a super business model, Malcolm Gladwell, the famous writer that wrote Tipping Point, said that this is what you will observe. At Tipping Point, there's contagiousness, 就是有传染性, 有感染力的. Little causes can have big effects, 巨杀可以成塔的. Change happens not gradually, but on a dramatic moment. 当事情要发生时, 砰, 它就发生了. Read the book. Or go to Wikipedia, they do summarize that for you. And then the thing, the three key elements, the previous slides talk about the phenomena. This one is talk about the key driving force that make these things happen. Number one, social law of the few, meaning you need to have three types of people to make things happen. 一种是认识很多人, connector. 一种叫 maven, who exchange, who are information brokers. The third type is salespeople. In your team or in your partners, you need all three types of people to make these things happen. Stickiness factor, your business model need to be sticky enough. Power of context, meaning all stars need to be aligned. 天时地利人和都得发生, 这一整个事情它的 contagiousness, 它的 tipping point 才会发生. 很快的, I only have 1 minute and 10 seconds. I am done with my sharing today. I hope you have learned and enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hsieh. Thank you very much. So Dr. Hsieh is asking if anyone has questions, please feel free to raise your hand. Over there. Just give me a second. No worry. You can have mine.
Mine is working now. Yeah.
So a couple of the success unicorn companies you shared.
I met you last year, right?
No.
Okay.
I definitely not. So a couple of the success stories you shared involves simple technology and application with addition of the creation of a community, right? Like you said. But like, how can these be kept proprietary if that's all it is? So like, if, for example, Ring, like you said, anyone can do that, can develop that technology. And there's nothing proprietary about creating a community. So how do you keep it proprietary,
you should say? You do it under the radar screen of a lot of other people. Somehow, right. By grassroots, it succeeds. Let me give you several examples. For example, we have an investment into another company called Plastic, PLASTIQ, which enables people to pay using their credit cards to entities that do not accept credit cards, but they only accept checks. So before the company got successful, the CEO actually went to a former American Express CEO and asked him to invest. This is some Harvard young kids who are able to persuade American Express former CEO to invest and be able to also line up to Visa, Master, and American Express, ask them to sign some kind of exclusive license with them. You do something, 鸭子滑水一阵子, and then 你出来你就已经少年跟功夫练成了, you come out, you are okay. And as whether the tipping point can happen or not, it depends on how well you are prepared and how well that business model looks like. But the most important thing is, if it turns out it doesn't happen right away, what you have to think about is how will the team or the partners of the company be able to modify that slightly. Think very hard. So one thing that's critical that I would like to share with you is eBay's co-founder in one interview said that the founders should not be greedy. You want to share as many stock options with your colleagues as possible. The founders should not be greedy. You want to make the company not too expensive for investors to come in. So I remember back in year 2001, I even saw Series F of PayPal. And PayPal is a huge company now. You just keep on going. Don't let your company die, and don't be greedy. Surround yourself with nice people. Yeah. OK, I think my time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you very much.